Something a little different for our call to worship today. I don't know about your yard, but in our yard, we have an amazing number of fireflies this year. It seems like five times as many. So our call to worship will be about fireflies by Ernestine Northover. A lake softly shimmering in the evening sunset glow. Fireflies are dancing above it, moving swiftly to and fro. Like a shower of confetti, they gyrate in a swirling mass, hovering over the surface, lightly humming as they pass. With all these fireflies parading, they are such a wondrous sight. Their grand display becomes a vision of absolute delight. Thousands of them have gathered to join this vast array, each one glittering with luminosity at the ending of the day. Let us worship God together. Please remain standing as we read our responsive sentences. We delight to draw near to you, gracious God. We rejoice in the many gifts you have given. The wisdom of God is not like any other. It draws us away from the world's agenda. God sends us into the world with new priorities. We are grounded in the Spirit, and we seek to love others as we love ourselves. Together our invocation, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Loving God, from our varied concerns and competing views, we come seeking our common humanity and the power to become uncommonly faithful. Open our hearts to receive your teaching and our hands to do your work. Steady our lives that we may not fear to undertake whatever mission you have for us. Through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Good morning, church. A warm summer welcome to one and all. The heart of our church is summed up in these words: no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Following the service, join us downstairs in the parish hall. You'll find something to nibble, something to sip, and someone to talk to. If you're a visitor or have a prayer request, please enter the information on a welcome card in the pew rack and place it in one of our three collection boxes in the back. Our programs for children, youth, and adults will resume in September. Our glorious chancel choir will return then as well. If you'd like to bring flowers from your garden or a work of art for the altar, call Connie Neese. Her phone number is in your order of worship, or speak with her after the service. There she is. All right, thank you. And now we'd like to ask everyone who is able to please stand and greet those around you. Our scripture lesson for the day is Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 through 13. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogue and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to God who is unseen. Then God, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them. For God knows what you need before you ask. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. In the reading of these words, may we hear the word of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Craig and Lucy. That was amazing. Wow. If you'll please take your order of worship, and we will join together as we read our call to prayer. We are created in the image of God. We walk in the presence of God. We live surrounded by the love of God. In the power of the Spirit, let us pray to God. Loving God, we give you thanks for the beauty found around us and within us. We thank you for the crystal clear waters that refresh us on hot days. We thank you for the laughter of children and for heartwarming conversations with old friends. We thank you, O God, for summer vacations, for time to be with family, and for time of renewal and refreshment. Oh God, we are grateful that you are a God who cares about every detail of our lives. Form us anew in the likeness of Christ. Open us up to new possibilities that we cannot even imagine. Give us eyes to see beyond our immediate wants and needs to things of eternal value. Help us to be good stewards of what we have been given in this life. Oh God, we pray today for so many in our world. We pray that where there is violence, we would find a peaceful solution. We pray that where there is hunger and thirst, we would find the resources to quench and to satisfy. Oh God, be with all of these needs. God, we seek to be faithful as we live out our lives together. Draw us closer to you during this time. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. growing up Southern Baptist, prayer was the very cornerstone of our faith expression. By the time a kid graduated from the baby nursery to the preschool Sunday school classroom, he was praying in full sentences, I assure you. I always felt inadequate in the public prayer department as I struggled with a touch of social anxiety and a wicked case of sweaty hand syndrome. And let me tell you, we Baptists, we love to hold hands and pray, don't we, Amy? Can I get an amen? I remember in vacation Bible school, when I was about 7 or 8, our minister challenged us to learn the words of the Lord's Prayer. Now, I'd heard it every Sunday in worship, but I could never quite get the cadence or the words in the right order. So every afternoon, I would come home from VBS, and I would sit in our velvet blue Lazy Boy rocker, and I would work on the prayer line by line, repeating the words out loud. Now, a quick disclaimer, the minister mentioned a prize for those who successfully memorized it by weekend. Public prayer gave me anxiety, but a competition? Well, now you're talking. I mean, let's be honest, the prize was most likely another Bible or an embossed bookmark with the Lord's Prayer on it, but I didn't care because I was in it to win it. Now, by the time I aged into our very large youth group, I realized that I had better have a few memorized lines for a prayer in the event of a surprise popcorn prayer circle. At the end of our youth group gatherings on Wednesday nights, our youth minister would have us circle up and hold hands, of course, while all 45 of us took turns praying. Now, we never knew it when it was our turn. That's why it was called popcorn prayer, or as I call it, Baptist prayer roulette. My anxiety levels peaked during these times, and it always seemed that I had to follow the best prayer of the group. We'll call her Molly. Molly, in her beauty, she was supermodel compatible. She was a star athlete. She was captain of the cheerleading squad. She was kind. She wore all the fashionable clothes. So, in general, perfect. At least she was, in my mind, as an awkward eighth grade girl. And she prayed the most beautiful, eloquent prayers, full complete sentences and everything. If Jesus had handed out gold stars for the best prayers, she would have received the first one. And all I could think about was, I'm going to have to follow her, and I'm going to sound like an incompetent babbling fool. And I usually did. But at least my turn was over, and my anxiety levels would go down just a bit. Expressions of public and communal prayer in my religious circles as a young adult continued. I attended countless college retreats and revivals, where the visiting minister would say, as we conclude tonight, every head should be bowed and every eye closed. That was secret language for, I'm going to pray now for 45 minutes while the band plays the same melody over and over, and you come forward to confess all of your despicable young adult sins. I call it prayer hostage. It always made me feel very squeamish and unsettled, as if there was some kind of end to a means. As if the minister up front praying secretly had one eye open, counting the number of souls marching down the aisle and waiting for those rebel rousers in the back pew to finally sense the Spirit's movement. For me, there was this palpable sense of inauthenticity that I could sense, and even in my very young heart. I grew up understanding prayer as a performance, rather than an intimate moment with God. But the most beautiful displays and notions of prayer that I did receive were often through foreign missionaries stopping into our church to share their stories and their struggles. Their prayers always seemed vulnerable, brief at times, heartfelt, as if they had seen and witnessed heartbreak somewhere in their journey. Their prayers always seemed sincere to me, reflecting a real sense of communion with God that I admired. Their life was prayer. These individuals and their families had traded the comfort of their American homes and their lives for huts and tents in developing nations to bring health care or access to education to some of the world's most forgotten places. Their prayers always inspired me, and their lives seemed to demonstrate the way Jesus described his closeness with God. And their presence in my midst and their very understanding of Jesus was a welcome balm for my anxious soul. In our scripture today, we find the disciples asking Jesus how to pray. After he returns to the group from his own time of intimate prayer, one of the disciples says, "Lord, teach us to pray." In Matthew's account, Jesus not only responds to their question with what to pray, but how to pray. I particularly love Eugene Peterson's version in The Message. He paints this beautiful, detailed picture unfolding. In this modernized version, Jesus says this: "And when you come before God, don't turn that into a theatrical production. All these people making a regular show out of their prayers, hoping for 15 minutes of fame, do you think God sits in a box seat? Here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so that you won't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there as simply and honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense God's grace. The world is full of so-called prayer warriors who are prayer ignorant. They're full of formulas and programs and advice, peddling techniques for getting what you want from God. Don't fall for that nonsense. This is your Father you are dealing with, and he knows better than you what you need. With a God like this loving you, you can pray very simply, like this: Our Father in heaven, reveal who you are. Set the world right. Do what is best. As above, so below. Keep us alive with 3 square meals. Keep us forgiven with you and forgiving others. Keep us safe from ourselves and from evil. You're in charge. You can do anything you want. You are ablaze in beauty. Yes, yes, yes." Prayer has made the headlines in the last couple of weeks, with a recent Supreme Court ruling centered on public displays of prayer, along with the separation of church and state laws. Many theologians and authors and ministers alike have responded with thoughtful articles and observations about prayer. Anne Lamott, best-selling Christian author and speaker, presents an opinion piece that was picked up by the New York Times recently. "How I wish her words had been written 30 years ago for my struggling teenage self to read." But I digress. Lamott's essay is filled with grit and humor and profound vulnerability in her classic tell it like it is style, and it hit home in my heart. Maybe some of you have already read it, but her words so powerful they bear repeating this morning as we reflect on Jesus' words. She says, "Many of us who believe in a reality beyond the visible realm, who believe in a soul that survives death, and who are hoping for seats in heaven near the dessert table, also recoil from the image of a coach praying on the 50-yard line. We're fighting furiously for rights and the planet, and we mean business. We believers, we Christians, we march and we rally, we put feet to prayer. But in our private lives, we pray. Isn't praying a bit Teletubbies," she says, "as we face off the urgent darkness? Nah. Prayer means talking to God, or to the great universal spirit, a.k.a. Gus, or not me, she says. Prayer connects us to a spirit both outside and within us, who hears and answers. It's like the comedian Flip Wilson saying, I'm going to pray now. Anybody want anything? Kind of. I do not understand much about string theory, but I know we are vibrations all the time. Between the tiny strings is space in which things can happen. The strings are infinite, the space between limitless. Prayer says to that space, I am tiny and helpless and needy and worried, but there's nothing I can do except send my love into that which is bigger than I. How do people like me who believe entirely in science and reason also believe that prayer can heal and restore? Well, I've seen it happen 1,000 times. God seems like a total show-off to me, she says. When I pray for all the places where we see Christ crucified, Ukraine, India, refugee camps, I see in my heart and in the newspaper that goodness draws near through UNICEF and Doctors Without Borders, through volunteers and through motley old us. I wake up praying. I say a prayer some sober people taught me to pray 36 years ago, because when all else fails, just follow the instructions. It helps me to not fixate on who I am, but whose. I am God's adorable, aging, self-centered, spaced-out beloved. I pray to be a good servant because I've learned that this is the path to happiness. I pray for my family and my sick friends that they have days of grace and healing. And I end my prayers, make me mindful of the needs of the poor. Then I put on my glasses, she says, and I let the dog out to pee and I start my day. I will have horrible thoughts about others, or someone who has seriously crossed me, or whose hair I praise falls out, or whose book fails. And I say to God, as I do every Sunday, look, I think we can both see what we have on our hands here. Help me not be such a pill. It's miserable to be a hater. I pray to be more like Jesus with his crazy compassion and reckless love. Some days go better than others. God sees beyond each person's awfulness to each person's needs. God loves them as is. God is better than I, she says. I lift up one of my grown Sunday school kids who is in ICU. I beseech God to intervene, and she does, through finding my girl a great nurse later that day. Nurses are God's answer 35% of the time. My prayer says to whomever might be listening, I care about her and I have no idea what to do, but to hold her in my heart and turn her over to something larger than me. And I hear what to do next. Make her one of my world-famous care packages, overpriced socks, a journal, and needless to say, communion elements tailored to her. It's love inside of wrapping paper. Especially when I travel, I talk to so many people who are absolutely undone by the miseries of the world. And all I can do is listen, commiserate, and offer to pray. Now, I can't turn politics around or war or the climate, but in listening, by opening my heart to someone in trouble, I create with them more love, less of a grippy clinch in our own little corner of the universe. When I am at my most rattled or in victimized self-righteousness, I go for walks, another way to put feet to prayer. I pray for help, and in some dimension outside of my mind, I relax. I can breathe again, and I say thank you. And I say thank you for the same flowers and the same trees and ferns and cactuses I pass every day. I say thank you, thank you, thank you. A walk is a great prayer. To make eye contact and smile is a kind of prayer, and it changes you. Fields and woods are the kingdom. There may be no one around, and the forest will speak to you, and the way it will speak to an animal, and that changes you. At bedtime, I pray again for my sick friends and the refugees, and I beg for sleep. I give thanks for the blessings of the day. I rest into the vision of the pearly moon outside my window that looks like a porthole into a larger reality. I have the theological understanding of a bright 8-year-old, but Jesus says we need to approach life like children, not like cranky know-it-alls, crazily busy, clutching our to-do list. One of my daily prayers is, "Slow me down, girlfriend." The prayer changes me. It breaks the toxic trance. And God says to Moses the first time they meet, "Take off your shoes. Be on the earth. Just breathe a moment." And as the great mystics and theologians of long ago say, I say too, what she said. Can I get an amen? So, like the disciples, we come to Jesus asking, teach us to pray. And may our hearts in these private moments echo the vibrations of both our inner lives and our outer world. And in our earnest, sometimes not even sure what to pray, prayers, may we become people truly of faith and hope and love. Our Father in heaven, reveal who you are. Set the world right. You are ablaze in beauty. Yes, yes, yes. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen.